Public money, public code. Global problems need global solutions. My name is Alexander Sander and I'm FSFE's policy manager. The Free Software Foundation Europe is a charity that empowers users to control technologies. And among these users are also governments, public bodies, administrations. So we are also working on a policy level in order to convince public bodies and governments to use free software. And in the next 45-50 minutes, I will tell you about our public money, public code campaign and what we've done during the Corona crisis and how we promoted free software and why we think it is a game changer when it comes to software during the Corona crisis. So first of all, I have a comic for you as an introduction to give you an example why free software is a very good solution, especially when it comes to government and public bodies. So I guess you are all more or less familiar with the US nuclear chain of command and this red button. But the question is, who installed the red button and how does the code look like and is the software really doing what it is supposed to do? So if there is no transparency, we won't see what the red button does and if it really follows this chain of command. And so therefore, it is very, very important to have transparent systems, especially when it comes to governments, to see if a software really does what it is supposed to do. And so when we are talking about free software, it's always about four freedoms. One of these freedoms is this transparency issue I just showed to you, but there are four freedoms. So when it is free software, you are free to use, study, share, and improve the software, which means you are free to use it for any purpose without any limitations or restrictions. You are free to study the code. It is transparent, so everybody can have a look at the code and see what the software does. You are free to share it without any restrictions or limitations. So even the price doesn't matter. So with free software, you can earn money. So this is not a problem at all. And you are also free to improve and modify the software and adapt it to your needs and demands. And so you can also give back to the community. And everybody is free to improve and modify the software. And once these four freedoms are guaranteed, then it is free software. And as I just show you in this one example with the red button, it is a very, very good idea for governments to use free software. And in the beginning, I will tell you a bit more about the arguments, especially for governments, why they should use free software. And then later on, we will have a look at the specific Corona problems we have seen and how free software was a game changer here and could be also a game changer for the future. So why should governments support free software and use it? There are some really good reasons for this, and also this is true for you and other users. So the first one is about digital sovereignty. So in order to establish trustworthy systems, public bodies must ensure they have the full control over the software and the computer systems they are using. And I mean, this is also true for you, but especially for governments, as we've seen with this red button, but also in recent debate about backdoors, for example, it is very, very important that there is a digital sovereignty and that especially governments and so also citizens know what software, for example, does. And also it's about public money. So public bodies are financed through taxes, and so they must make sure they spend the funds in the most efficient way possible. And so that's why we started this public money, public code campaign. And but maybe first of all, let's have a look at free software compared to proprietary software. And this will also make it very, very clear why free software, especially for governments, is a very good solution. So first of all, you have no interoperability if you have proprietary software. So systems can't talk to each other. You can't share data easily. You have no open standards, no open formats. So we will always have problems with sharing, for example, documents or data with and not just within this network, but if you go to, for example, other countries or administrations using other systems, then you have no interoperability, and this is really a huge issue. And you're also very quickly in a vendor login if you are using proprietary software. So you buy a license from one vendor, and once you want to have a change in the software, you always have to go back to this one vendor and ask them if they please could do so, and you also don't know about the costs. It is very hard to predict future costs of these software because you never know if the vendor will do, for example, updates, and if he does and modify the software to your needs, you never know how much the costs will be. And you also have this low acceptance by citizens as the code is not transparent. So especially with these tracing apps, we will have a look at this later on as well. We have seen that there is no acceptance by the citizens if there is no transparent code. And also economic reason again is that your investments are quickly lost. So if you pay money for a license, this money is just away, so you can't use it, for example, to modify your software or to buy another software or whatever. So every time you are paying for a license, this investment is just lost. And also you are having security issues with proprietary software, as you are not able to look into the code. You have to trust your vendor that they're really, that the software is really doing what it is supposed to do, or it is really, really hard to check out security issues. It's way easier to do so with free software, so we will see it in a minute. And let's compare it now. So the solution is for these problems is always free software, because you have this interoperability due to open standards. So there's really no problem with sharing data among borders, but also with different software systems, as you always have these open standards that guarantee that your data are also readable with another vendor's software. You have the independence through the free license, so you can go from one vendor to another and, for example, ask for modifications. You can do it by your own, and you are also free to share it with others, as I just said, with the four freedoms. And this also gives you the possibility to collaborate together, and so also to share risks and cost. For example, administrations are more or less having always the same needs and demands. So one city has the same or nearly the same demand than another city. So why shouldn't they just cooperate and share the development costs, but also costs for future updates and or modifications of the software? And this also gives you the chance to have predictable costs, and you can easily switch vendors. And so this gives you also a lot of freedom and also sovereignty. And as just mentioned, the system is transparent by default, so the four freedom guarantee you that you have open source code, so that you can see what the software does. And so this also gives you the chance to involve local partners. This don't have to be necessarily just coders, but also other stakeholders who could help you to improve your software. And for example, also in order to make it more secure, your solution, so you can run bug bounty programs or hackathons or other projects in order to improve the security of your code. So free software gives you the chance to have a very secure product in the end. At least you have the chance to do so. It doesn't mean that the software itself is secure just because it is free software, but as the code, for example, is transparent, everybody have the chance to look at the code and also help in order to modify it and make it more secure. So we see that especially for governments, it's a very, very good reason to use free software solutions, but this is for sure also true for companies, individuals, and all other users around the world. So As I just mentioned, some economic reasons why governments should invest in free software. I have some more for you, and one is very, very interesting in my point of view, and that is that the governments are one of the biggest player in the IT purchases. So they are among, also they make up to 27% of the revenue of software firms comes from governments. So they are a key player on the market. And if just imagine if these administrations work together in order to procure software, for example, then they are really a key player. But at the moment, most of the times they are acting alone. So that's why they are quickly running in these vendor lock-ins and paying or wasting a lot of money. And so just imagine what happened if we have this, let's say up to 27% of the revenue directly invested in free software projects. I'm pretty sure we would have way better solutions in place than we are having today. And also, if you look to countries which already introduced some free software regulations, for example, France, you can quickly see that it helps your local IT market, and that it helps. So it also helps your local economy. And so in France, we have a free software friendly regulation compared to other countries in Europe, and this led in the last years to the fact that there is a significant increase of companies using and distributing free software on a yearly basis. Also, the IT-related startups are increasing year by year, and so also the jobs are increasing in this sector. And what's also very, very interesting is that on the other hand, software-related patents are decreasing if you are going in the direction of free software. And so here you can see with these figures that even if you are introducing the first steps, let's say it like this, in order to go into the direction of a free software policy, you will directly see it on your local IT market that there are more and more companies and more jobs created if you switch to free software. So it's not only a technical, or there are not only technical reasons why you should switch to free software, but also economic reasons. And also the inclusion of small and medium enterprises is something which we've seen so far. For example, in Barcelona, Barcelona is a city which really invests a lot of money in free software. So they have some rules stating that 70% of the software budget have to be invested in free and open source software. And this also led to the fact that from 3,000 companies which have been involved so far in the development of these software projects, there have been 16% small and medium enterprises. So we can clearly see once you decide that you want to go in the direction of free software, it will help not only your IT business and in the region, but also will help small and medium enterprises. So from an economic perspective, there are also very, very good reasons why governments should support free software and use more free software in the future. So we can see that it helps SMEs in the region, and that they will become strong partners if you switch to free software. You will have a lot of autonomy once you have free software, so you can adapt the software to your needs. You can have a tailored software which really does what you want to have to be done by the software, and it's not the other way around. And it's also very, very efficient to use free software because you don't have to reinvent the wheel again and again, and your investments are not lost, but you can share it with others. And also, so this is how you can improve the software, and administrations can collaborate across borders. This happens already today, but so this is why we started our Public Money, Public Code campaign. We want to see it all over the place, and every administration around the world should use free software because it will help us it will help us as a society, but also will save a lot of money, and we will have way better products in the end than it is until now. So, as I just said, roughly 3 years ago, we started our campaign, Public Money, Public Code, in order to be precise with our demands and to not just talk about it, but also have a clear campaign with clear demands where we can go on a policy level to decision makers and tell them about the advantages of using free software. And so we started to this campaign with an open letter where we demanded legislation requiring that publicly financed software developed for the public sector should be made publicly available under a free and open source software license. So quite easy. If it is public money, it should be public code as well. And so with this campaign and open letter with some of the arguments I just showed you, we started to reach out to decision makers and on mostly all fields of a policy level. So from a local level up to a European, sometimes even a global level, we are promoting the idea of public money, public code, and we are also asking for support of this campaign by individuals or other organizations who follow us in our demand. And we have more than 180 organizations who are supporting our demand. Among these are Wikimedia, the WordPress Foundation, the Open Source Initiative, the Open Knowledge Foundation, and other really, really strong national, regional, but also international NGOs who are following us here. And also, until now, more than 28,000 individuals are supporting this call. So if you haven't signed this call so far and our open letter, feel free to do so. Go on publiccode.eu, sign the open letter, but also if you are part of an organization who didn't sign it so far, you can also reach out to us as an organization and support us here with our demand. And what makes us very happy at the moment is that also administrations are following our demand and also signed our open letter. So what happened until now is that we have administrations from Sweden, Germany and Spain who are supporting this call, among them, for example, the city of Barcelona, but also the parliament of Asturias. So also administrations are free to join us. They already did. So if you are part of an administration, or if you know people from administrations, you're also free to sign this open letter to join our call to public money, public code. But also you can reach out to us directly if you think we should reach out to a specific administration and help us here to get the connection. So please feel free to spread the word, to promote this campaign as well, because especially during this crisis, we have seen that our contacts we established before have been very useful, and that also our campaign and the demand for public money, public code was also already in the minds of most of the decision makers, and so they knew what we are talking about and why our idea is quite good, especially during the crisis. We also released a brochure dedicated for administrations where we collected all the arguments, some of them you just heard, but also more detailed articles about procurement procedures, about legal questions and things like this. You will find this brochure on our website, fsfe.org. You can download it as PDF. It's available in German, in English. We are also working on more translation of this brochure for sure. And you can also order a hard copy if you wish, if you want to share it with decision makers you know or people from administrations. So feel free to reach out and to just download it on our website or just order a hard copy if you wish. And now let's go into the details of the current crisis. And so during the corona crisis, we have seen that we have global problems and that we need global solutions. And in the next minutes, I will tell you more about these problems we have seen and also about the solutions we have seen. And I will also tell you what FSFE has done during the time in order to promote free software and how this worked. So, as I just said, we have seen global problems and we have seen similar demands on the other side. So especially during this crisis, we have seen it's a global crisis and the global solution is very similar. For sure, demands are not necessarily exactly the same in every country or in every region, but they are very similar. And especially when it comes to hardware and software, we have seen that there has been or still is specific software needed. And for example, just think about your own situation. I guess you occurred it during your home office time or while you have been remotely working, that there are lots of problems with software. And also the debates around the Corona tracing apps, which we've seen so far, showed us that we need global solutions and that these global solutions come with open standards as we need this interoperability. We need the independence with free licenses so that we can work across borders. We also need to collaborate in order to foster innovation and to tackle this crisis. And we also need transparency in order to have the acceptance by citizens once they should use specific software, for example. And also we need to involve as many stakeholders as possible and as are useful. And we have to make sure that it is possible that we can include stakeholders across borders. And so therefore, it is very important to have the four freedoms guaranteed, the four freedoms of free software to use, study, share, and improve, and that it is a game changer if you have free software in place compared to proprietary solutions or software, as I just mentioned, on a general level. And now let's see, for example, around the debates with apps, what happened here in the last months and why free software was and still is a game changer. So in the very beginning of this debate, we started to release three demands for these apps. And we said, once you have a tracing app, we want to have it to be used voluntarily. It must respect fundamental rights and it have to be free software. It have to be free software, for example, in order to see if the fundamental rights are respected. I guess you had also very hard discussions in your country around especially respecting fundamental rights with these tracing attempts, and especially around the app debate. We have seen that there are centralized or decentralized options, that they are proprietary, closed source solutions and free software solutions that really helps us to see, for example, if fundamental rights are respected. And so therefore, we started very early in this debate to release these three demands and get reached out to decision makers and administrations and governments in order to make sure that at least these three demands from our side will be recognized and that governments will follow these recommendations. And quickly after we started to do so, the e-health network of the European Union, for example, so it's a network of the European Commission and the member states, released recommendations for these tracing apps for the member states, and they really followed our demand and our approach, and they said it have to be free software in order to make these apps reusable, to have the interoperability, especially if you are traveling across borders, you want to work together with this data also across borders, and you have the security and the acceptance by the citizens as the code is transparent. So the decision makers understood quite quickly why it is a very good solution to have free software tracing apps, and so that's why they released these recommendations and following our approach. Also, a couple of weeks later, the World Health Organization released a paper to suggest countries in the world to, once they are working on such a tracing app, to release it as free software. So we have seen that, especially in the debate around apps, our arguments were well received, and that governments and public bodies understood why it is so important to have free software solutions here in place. And a similar debate happened around these hackathons, so not just tracing apps have been on in the debate, but also other software solutions. So governments started to organize hackathons, so nearly every country had such a hackathon in Europe and organized something to find software solutions in order to tackle this crisis. And these hackathons for sure have been funded by governments. So we again stepped in with our campaign, Public Money, Public Code, and said, once you have global solutions, they must be globally available, and this could be only done with free software. And so we reached out to decision makers, for example, on social networks, but also with mails, and we made phone calls and reached out also to the organizer of these hackathons in order to make sure that the results of these hackathons are released under a free software license. Sometimes it works, sometimes it didn't, especially with the help of our community, where we also ask for support in order to reach out on social networks, for example. We managed it to convince some organizers of these hackathons to release the results as free software. With some, it doesn't work. So this also shows us that there is a long way to go, and that we have to continuously work on convincing decision makers and tell them about the advantages of free software. So please feel free to do so as well. So once you see something, for example, on social networks, it's quite easy to comment and just be, for example, the first one who is commenting on these hackathons and say, hey, please keep in mind, if you are having these solutions, they should be available everywhere in the world, because it's a global crisis and not just a crisis of your country or a crisis of the European Union or your region. It's a global crisis, and that's why we need global solutions, and these global solutions have to be free software, because else it's not a global solution, and it won't help us at all. So it's very easy to reach out to people, to tell them about the advantages of free software, and so you are invited to help us here as well. If you need help here, we prepared also some snippets you can use. Just go to our website, and we have dedicated articles explaining you how to do so, and as well you will find some snippets if you have problems formulating the best way to reach out. But also you're free to do it with your own words, but always keep in mind we have to tell about the advantages still, because even if we had I would say a kind of success with these tracing apps, it doesn't mean that now everything is fixed and that now everybody understood about the advantages of free software. There's still a long way to go, and therefore we need especially your help in order to convince decision makers to use free software. We also did a very, very interesting podcast during that time with Louis Falcon and Axel Braun from the GNU Health Project. So if you want to listen to this special episode of our Software Freedom podcast, feel free to do so. We will find it on our website. It is a very, very interesting project, the GNU Health Project, which for sure have been in place already before the crisis, and this project also had solutions in place to tackle this crisis, and it's all free software, and it is a very important project and a very interesting and good project. So feel free to learn more about free software and the health sector by listening this special episode of our Software Freedom podcast. I just want to mention it, because for me it was also very interesting to see what they are doing since years, and it's so important and so crucial what they are doing. So you should listen to this. I liked it a lot. So, and another problem I just mentioned is the remote working tools most of us have been sometimes forced to use. Some are still forced to use solutions they don't like. And so what we have done together with our supporters is to collect in a wiki solutions that are free software and that are quite as good as other software people downloaded or used during the pandemic. And so we started to collect, for example, tools for video conferencing or for collaboration platforms and software like this, where you have free software alternatives in place, which are quite good and well working, and they are tested by us, but also by our community. So feel free to check out this wiki if you are looking for a special solution, or if friends or colleagues of you are looking for a special solution, just go to our wiki, and I'm pretty sure you will find something which helps you. But for sure, this is a living document, so also feel free if there's a missing solution, just add it in the wiki or send us an email and we will add it. And so this is a place where we collect free software solutions for remote working, and this is also, I think, something what is very helpful, not just for individuals but also for companies and administrations, to show that there are good alternatives in place, and that you don't have to grab the easiest solution which will push you in a vendor lock-in quite quickly, and where you have to pay a lot of money in the near future. And the last point I want to talk to you about in this talk is that we've also seen loads of commercials during the time by companies using the term free software for their products in order to push people into vendor lock-ins, and giving something to the people and consumers out there, what was not free software or what is not free software, but maybe freeware or something else. Still, this software doesn't come with the four freedoms, and companies try to promote and to hijack the term free software. And what we've done is to write an article and a checklist in order to tell people or to educate people on the four freedoms again, and that they have to be careful with some advertisements. And I want to show you the most or the worst I've seen so far, and tell you why it is not free software and why you should take care. Even if it looks like a good offer, it doesn't mean it is a good offer, and you might end up in a vendor lock-in and have pay a lot soon. So what we've seen, for example, that there are offers that the software is offered for free, but it is also time limited on the other hand, so you are free to use it for the next 3 months and then you have to buy a license. So this is clearly not free software, so it's very likely that you have to pay fees for the software soon if you want to use it. So this is how you've been pushed into a vendor lock-in. So once you use the software for 3 months, you don't want to change the system once you set up everything. And so then you are more eager to pay for it after using it for 3 months, for example. And so this is clearly not free software, it's something else. But free software would guarantee you that you can use it forever and not just time limited. Another commercial was that it was promoted to use the software for a specific amount of workstations, or that a limited number of users could use the software. This is also clearly not free software. As we know, the four freedoms guarantee you that as many people can use it as you wish, so you can share it with others, and there is no limitation by the number of workstations or the number of users. So it's clear that this is also not free software, and again, it's also very likely that once you are growing, or you need another or you want to have another license in this case for another workstation, then you have to pay. And also, once they are upgrading to a new version, it's also very likely that this offer is then not in the place anymore, and you have to pay the licenses then for all workstations and all users. So please be sure that you have a real free software and not a limited one as it is proposed here, because this is not free software but something else. It's also happened a lot that during the crisis, application software was provided free of charge only for your business. And again, this is for sure not free software, and it is also very likely that after the crisis your business then have to pay for licenses, and because free software would say this software is free for everybody and not just for your business. So this is clearly also not free software, but something where you will end up quickly in a vendor lock-in. Something we've seen also again is it is somehow similar to the time limited offer, but here many companies said you can use a trial version, a full, sometimes full free trial version for a while, and so this is also very clear that this trial period will end at one day, and then you have to pay. So what looks like a good offer today will push you also again here in the vendor lock-in, and you have unpredictable costs, and you never know when and how much you have to pay then for the next licenses. And once your trial period will end, you will find out very, very quickly that this is not free software, but again, something else. And some companies also said during this crisis that they will make their software available for free for hospitals and schools or other specific sectors, which have been hit by the crisis very hard. And again, this might look like a good offer if you are a hospital or school to say, oh, there is a very good software, I want to have this, it's for free because I'm a school. But it will end up in a vendor lock-in because it's just for this sector, and you never know how long they will have this offer in place. And once again here, if you have an upgraded version, a new version, then you have to pay for sure for these licenses, and then it's not available anymore. And also you don't have the freedoms to adapt and modify the code, so you need to go to the next upgraded version because this version you're having now might run out of support. And so also on the long run, this will be very expensive for you, and you will end up in a vendor lock-in. And then the most wild thing I've seen so far is that you can win a license, and they promote it with free software. I mean, this is also very clear that it is not free software. So even if you are among the lucky winners, it doesn't mean that you can adapt and modify the software. It doesn't mean that there will be also endless support for this software. So once you won the license, there might be an upgrade to a new version, and then you have to pay for the license again, and you are also in the vendor lock-in, and it's also not about free software. So even if you win a license, you are not really a lucky winner, because you will end up in a vendor lock-in, at least on the long run, and you have to pay a lot. So this is not a win at all, and also it is not free software. And then what we've seen also is that some creators said we will release this as open source, and yeah, so now it is there. But if you check the details, then we figured out with most of the others that not the full software is open source or free software, but just parts of it. And also keep in mind that once there is an upgraded version, then it also means that you have to switch to the upgraded version because they are running, they are not supporting the other one anymore. And also, if just parts of the software is released under open source license or free software license, this also means that you are not free to go to another vendor and adapt it to your needs, because the core part of the software, for example, might be released not under a free software license, so you have this vendor lock-in again. So this is also something we have seen. So if there is an announcement like this, please be sure that the full software is released under a free software license, and you have to be really, really clear that it is like that, because else it is also very likely that you will end up in a vendor lock-in. So again, free software licenses allows sharing of code in any jurisdictions across borders without any limitations. So solutions developed in one country can be reused and adapted in another one. So this is also true, not just for countries, but yeah, for everything. So this is something you should also every time keep in mind if you choose a free software solutions. And it's especially true for governments, as we've seen during this international crisis, that we need software around the world, and not just in a single country, and that we need reusable solutions, so that if we have an innovation in one country, we need to make sure that it's reusable in all other countries in the world in order to tackle this global crisis. And so therefore, our call for public money, public code is now even more important than ever before. And so, as I just said, already before the crisis, hundreds of organizations and thousands of people followed our demand, and we have seen, especially during this crisis, that it is now even more important than ever before. So please help us in order to spread the word, talk about our public money, public code campaign, but also about the FSFE in general and about free software in general. And maybe you can join a local group, or you can also go to our website and help us translations, for example. So this is also something which is every time very important. So please help us. Please help the mission of Free Software Foundation Europe, but also the mission of free software in general. So use free software, share free software, talk to others. So you don't have to be a coder in order to be an advocate for free software. And I think it is us together who can make this world a better place, especially when it comes to software. And I think we can alter the face of the world together if we share expertise and if we are following the ideas of free software and the ideals, and collaborate, share, and you do it together. And so therefore I was really happy to give you this talk. I hope you learned a bit, and maybe you're also motivated now a bit more to contribute, and please feel free to do so. And if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them, and also feel free to reach out to me or to us directly. You can send me an email. You will find me on social networks. This is also true for the FSFE, so we are on social networks. You can reach us by phone and mail. So if you have any questions or recommendations, or if you want to join us, please feel free to reach out to me or to us, and we are happy to help you. And thanks for your attention. I hope you had a good conference so far, and I hope you will have also a good conference for the next hours. And thanks for listening to this talk, and stay healthy. Bye bye.
Thank you, Alexander, for your talk. It was quite informative. So on the questions, we have a question from Chandresa, which says, what has influenced the use of 70% free and open source software in the city of Barcelona that you mentioned on your talk?
That's a quite good question. In general, it was about a change in the government. So people voted for a new government in Barcelona, and one of the points they want to change was to use more free software, and that's what they did. And also I think what happens there was that there were quite ambitious individuals who pushed the use of free software, and that also helped a lot. I just want to mention Francesca Pria, for example, who helped us a lot, or who helped Barcelona a lot to use more free software, and also to promote it and to network with other cities. And I think they just figured out quite quickly that this was a good decision, and that's why they did more and more steps into the direction to use free software. And one day they ended up in having a clear rule stating that 70% of the budget have to be invested in free software. Still, in the end, I would say it was a election, and also part of the programs of the parties who run for this election. And so that's why it happened that Barcelona is one of the new lighthouses, I would say, in Europe when it comes to the use of free software.
Thank you. And we have Ariane who asks, how can you support us to push public money and public code initiative in Kosovo?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, it's very hard for me to be not in Pristina at the moment. So else I just would offer a workshop quite now, and where we could go ahead and discuss things like this.
But what I can offer is to have a workshop in the next days or weeks, whenever you wish, where we can discuss this together and think about strategies or activities we could take and in order to promote public money, public code. It's quite simple. We have loads of our material also online on our website publiccode.eu, where you can see what we've done so far and how we've done so far. We have also some wiki pages on where we explain how to reach out to administrations, for example. We have example letters which could be, for example, translated and could be used for doing so. But else, yeah, what I really would like to do is to have a workshop with you guys, if you wish, and we can do it here in this big blue button instance and just meet and discuss on the best strategies on how to do so. In general, it's quite easy. Sometimes it's just about sending an email in the very beginning and try to reach out to decision makers, try to influence processes. For example, as I just said with Barcelona's, sometimes changes come with elections. And if you push the idea of public money, public code into an election program of the parties, then they might change laws afterwards. And this could also be a strategy. And this is what we are doing. Ways on how to support public money, public code, also in your country, and I'm happy to host a workshop or also be I'm available on via email, or we can have a call or whatever. So just reach out to me.
So on the beginning of your talk, you mentioned proprietary software licenses. What about the free software licenses? How hard or how easy it is for a software to comply them? And also the distinguishing factor between open source and free software licenses, can you explain it a bit?
I mean, in general, there are loads of licenses, and in general, it's about the four freedoms. So if these four freedoms are guaranteed to use, share, study, and improve, then it's a free software license in the end, but there are some restricted licenses, some more open licenses like copyleft licenses. However, you can go to the Open Source Initiative or the Free Software Foundation in the US, who have lists or provide lists of accepted licenses, and you are free to choose one of these. And it depends a bit on the project you are running or what's the idea of your software project, and then you will find the best license on one of these lists. However, we also created a tool. It's called Reuse, and this makes licensing a bit more easier. You can find it on our website as well, and this also helps you in order to stick with the license and to continue and to have compatible licenses in the end, so that you won't run into troubles with this. I have also a website on this, and also if you have a specific license question, we are also having a license question team, so you can also just shoot us an email with your specific question on the license you are having, and then we will try to answer this. There are lawyers on this list who could help here, and I think if you, however, find this, a license on the FSF website or the OC website, then it's a free software license, and else it's something else. What we've seen in the last years, for example, is that there are really also loads of companies using the term open source in order to promote pieces of their software which might be open source, but the general software project is not open source in the end, so just parts of it, it's open source. And so therefore you also have to be really, really careful in order to check if the license is for the full software or just parts of it. And so But I think to talk about license could be another huge talk. So as there are so many licenses in place, however, I recommend you, if you have specific questions, our license question team, which is reachable via mail, and our reuse project, which helps you to make licensing way easier than it is to for most of the projects today.
Thank you. We have Dashamir, who wants to know if FSFE supports any coding projects.
It depends. So actually, we are not a coding organization or something like this. So it's more about advocating, telling about the advantages of free software, also helping with legal questions, for example. Still, that doesn't mean that we are not releasing any software. For example, I just mentioned the reuse project where we helped or coded, and also we are just started, I think it was 1 week ago, a call for our volunteer supporters or other interested persons who want to work for free software or want to do something for the free software environment, and who might need support, be it like technical or even financially. So this is also something what we are running in order to support our community. So you can also find this call on our website. And if there is a very interesting and good coding project, it might be also possible that we step in there. So, but I mean, it's not our main, our main work is not about coding. It's more about explaining and helping, especially for example, decision makers to understand the advantages of free software. And then, as I just showed with our public money, public code campaign, to convince governments to use free software. And this is how we want to help the free software environment.
Okay, thank you, Alexander, for your talk, and it was an honor to have you here.
Yeah, thanks for having me, and I hope next year we can see us in real life, and would be happy to do so. Thanks a lot, and have fun with the last hours of your conference.
Bye, thank you.
Bye-bye.
For our next session, we have a talk, which is the risk of IoT.